This is For Keeps, a podcast about collections and connections. I'm David Peterkofsky. This is a collector's story that's not so much about collecting physical items as it is about preserving a tradition. That tradition first emerged in the early 19th century, was collected diligently by an academic in the early 20th century, and is still making waves here in the 21st century, thanks in large part to social media.
I was collecting the shanties, collecting the sea shanties. I'd already, the last 2 years at Harvard, I'd collected shanties and along the eastern coast and Marblehead and Salem and then came down to Sailor Snug Harbor. And I'd made such a good showing in the shanties that Kittredge was eager for me to have all the summer for my collection.
That's the voice of the collector in question, James Madison Carpenter, recorded in 1972 at the age of 84. And describing his work collecting sea shanties, the catchy work songs that helped make the physical labor of sailing go a bit more smoothly, at least in theory. By the time the Mississippi-born, Harvard-educated scholar set out to capture the tradition, the dominance of big sailing ships had receded, and the shanties that had been handed down as an oral tradition from one generation of sailors to the next were in danger of disappearing forever. But for the better part of 6 years, between 1929 and 1935, Carpenter devoted his postdoctoral studies to a variety of folk song traditions, sea shanties among them. For much of his work, he combed the coast of Great Britain, most notably Northern England and Scotland, armed with a typewriter and a dictaphone that used wax cylinders to record the voices of local singers performing the melodies. In all, Carpenter collected more than 3,000 songs, including about 650 recordings capturing all or part of maritime songs. Late in Carpenter's life, he sold his entire collection, his trove of sea shanties included, to the Library of Congress for others to enjoy. But more recently, our culture's appreciation for sea shanties seems to have hit yet another high watermark. In early 2021, singer Nathan Evans posted a video of himself performing the tune Wellerman, an old maritime song that originated in New Zealand.
Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
And it went viral, with 95 million views of its video on YouTube and more than 1 billion views of Wellerman-related clips on TikTok as of early 2022. Toss in the popularity of shanty sing-along events around the world, and you might say that sea shanties are the trend that may never end. And all that brings us to Bob Walser. He's a musician, educator, and scholar based in Minneapolis, and he's part of a team of scholars working on a project based out of Scotland's University of Aberdeen to catalog Carpenter's collection and to promote its use for study and further appreciation. I reached out to Bob to help tell the story of James Madison Carpenter and to help shed light on the tradition of sea shanties and why that tradition still captures our imaginations. An added bonus, Bob has actually worked as a shantyman, demonstrating the songs for many years at the popular Mystic Seaport Museum on the coast of Connecticut. But before we set sail, let's get an answer from Bob as to the most obvious question on the subject of sea shanties. What exactly is a sea shanty? How would you define it and differentiate it from other work songs or folk songs?
Well, that's easy, although the popular conception and the technical definition are somewhat at odds. The technical definition would be that it is specifically a work song, and there are various kinds of shanties depending on the context. An example of a song that most people would think of as a shanty, which actually is or was a shanty, would be Blow the Man Down, which is a song, a call and response song, wherein the leader of the song sings a solo and the group responds together. And while they're singing, they are doing some kind of work. In the case of Blow the Man Down, they would be hauling on a line on a square rigged vessel to raise a topsail or something like that. So the solo goes, "Oh, blow the man down, bullies, blow the man down." And the people pull on the words "way, hey," and "blow the man down." So there's two strong pulls in the chorus. So that's one form of a shanty. It's a halyard shanty. And there are a few other forms for other kinds of work in which there would be just a single pull in the chorus, or songs that are sung for long, steady work. But specifically, a shanty is a work song, although the sort of great shanties, or well-known shanties, are from the age of deep water sail. There are other maritime work song traditions called shanties, which Carpenter knew nothing about because he never encountered them, along the east coast of the United States in the Menhaden fishery. There were net hauling songs, which were known as shanties as well. It's a kind of a slippery word in contemporary society. It kind of means anything that's remotely salty, as in the TikTok shanty craze of a year ago, where a song which was never a work song but had a maritime theme was adopted by the world at large as a shanty, when in fact it wasn't really a work song. So the popular definition or understanding of it and the technical definition are not congruent all the time, but there you go.
So in terms of pop culture, if it's salty, it's a shanty.
Well, that seems to be how it's used mostly these days, yeah.
Though it remains popular, the sea shanty tradition first caught on a couple of centuries back.
There's very little evidence of any kind of shantying in any widespread sense before the beginning of the 19th century. And the confluence of a couple of factors brought about the rise of shantying, starting perhaps in the 1820s, maybe a little earlier, maybe a little later. And they were used primarily during sort of a great age of sail, but as steam replaced sail from the middle of the 19th century onward, the tradition died out until, by many tellings, the last shanty sung at work on a sailing ship was "Fire Down Below," sung by Stan Hugel shortly before the wreck of the Garth Pool.
That shipwreck was in 1929, but the earlier heyday of the shanty tradition resulted, in large part, from the shifting economics of trade.
Prior to the early 19th century, vessels lay in port and would send out notices of one sort and another to say, okay, this vessel's going to sail for XYZ place. Let's say it's lying in New York and they're going to sail to London. They would stay there until the ship was full. When they had a full load, they would take off and go to London, starting with the famous Black Ball Line. And the economics of sail changed. And the owners of the Black Ball Line said, we're going to have a ship that sails on a given date, whether it's full or not. And it's going to sail from Liverpool to New York and the other way around. And they had initially, I believe it was two sailings a month on the 1st and the 15th, more or less. They wouldn't always sail with a full cargo. And so the economics of running the ship tightened up. And of course, your biggest expense in many businesses is personnel expense, and so crew sizes were cut. And it was important that everybody work a bit harder because the crews were smaller.
Also critical to the development of the sea shanty tradition was the involvement of African-American sailors.
In the period before the Civil War, working at sea was one of the better opportunities for free blacks in the United States. So there was a much higher proportion of African-American workers on ships at that time than in the population at large. These workers brought with them pre-existing work song traditions. There's evidence of songs for rowing and cargo handling and whatever sung by black workers prior to the great age of shantying. So these workers came on board these ships and brought with them work song traditions, some of them from very close to maritime contexts like loading cargoes. And these were expanded and adapted in that time period to the great flowering of shanty. of course, the other reason that there were blacks on ships was that for those who were enslaved, their owners would sometimes put them to sea and obviously steal their wages or take their wages. But that was another reason why there were, like I said, a higher proportion of black workers on sailing ships than in the population at large.
While studying at Harvard, James Madison Carpenter developed an interest in sea shanties, among other forms of song, and his scholarly curiosity about them led to quite a bit of travel.
He was also interested in ballads and other folk song forms, but for whatever reason, when he started doing his thesis at Harvard, shanties were the thing that he decided to focus on. And he was not a young man when he did this. He came to this interest in midlife and was studying under the great George Lyman Kitteridge at Harvard, very famous scholar who was supervising him. And for whatever reason, he got interested in the shanties. And initially, he hung out or went to places in the United States, to Marblehead, Massachusetts, or Sailor's Snug Harbor, which was a retirement home for sailors on Staten Island in New York. And he went to these places and met sailors. And I'm not sure at what point he started actually making sound recordings. His earliest recordings, he didn't keep them because wax cylinders could be shaved for reuse. They were intended for short-term recordings like a dictaphone, you know, where you use it once it's dictated, then you reuse this wax cylinder. And so his earliest sound recordings that he made weren't saved. So I don't know when he exactly started recording, but it was as part of his thesis research. And his thesis was completed in 1929. And then the summer before he finished his thesis, he went to England and continued the research there, which he'd begun in the United States. And he had such a good time that once he got his degree, he went back to England on this Sheldon Fellowship.
How about Carpenter's process for collecting the songs, so to speak? I know he traveled with recording devices, but he was also making note of the song lyrics as well. Is that right?
Yeah, one of the curiosities of the Carpenter collection is the way that Carpenter did his work. He had a dictaphone, which was a good thing to have as a recording device in those days because he didn't necessarily have electricity every place that he went, and it was operated by a spring-wound clockwork mechanism, so he could make sound recordings. But cylinders were large and bulky and expensive, and so his method was usually to record only one or two verses, maybe three, of a given song, and then to stop the machine and use a portable typewriter to take down the remaining text of the song. So obviously that process assumes that the songs don't change much from verse to verse, which in folk performance actually does happen quite a bit. You know, the way if you go to a typical folk song collection, it will have one line of melody for your song and many verses written underneath it. So a lot of people assume that they're pretty much the same from verse to verse. And so you lose the nuance of performance that often takes place. But that's a, you know, that's just the way it was conceived of and the way that he did his work.
Because Carpenter's work was so exhaustive, with massive amounts of audio and printed materials to sift through, it's presented challenges to Bob and to others involved in the Carpenter Collection project out of the University of Aberdeen.
In the Carpenter Collection itself, the sound recordings are separate from the texts of the songs, and so reuniting them can be a bit of a challenge. But that's a lot of the work that the Carpenter team has done over the years. So we've reunited the texts and the tunes to these songs. A given song in the Carpenter Collection can exist from one performance by one singer on one particular date in many iterations. There might be a cylinder recording. Carpenter later copied those cylinder recordings onto discs, acetate, I believe. So there might be a disc copy of the cylinder recording, or even multiple disc copies of the cylinder recording. Then there might be a typescript, and typescript sometimes in a rough draft and maybe a fair copy as well. And then Carpenter sometimes listened to those recordings and made musical notations. So there might be a notation as well. So a given performance on one day by one singer could result in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 7 different sort of little bits and pieces in the Carpenter collection. So working with the collection is really a challenge.
I was going to say it's a lot to unpack per song.
Yeah, exactly. I wound up creating some computer tools to do it because there were just so many bits and pieces flying around. Just the shanties alone, Carpenter recorded around 650 shanties, many repetitions. But, you know, that represents, I don't know, thousands of little individual bits and pieces scattered around the collection that I had to find all the pieces of this song and put them together and all the pieces of that song and put them together. It's quite a challenge.
And when you're talking about challenges, how about the efforts Carpenter went to, both in the U.S. and in Britain, to track down the shanties and people who could perform them? And how did he go about finding the singers he interviewed? Did he go from dock to dock? What was his process?
Yeah, that's, as I understand it, that's pretty much what he did. I don't know how he started in the United States, but clearly going to a place like Sailor Snug Harbor was a smart choice because that was a retirement home for sailors. So they'd be there, they'd be in one place, and it was older sailors who were the people who were likely to know shanties. And so that's certainly something that he did in the United States. And he did the same thing at various places when he went to the United Kingdom. There were a couple of sailors' homes that he visited while he was there. But he also made, he bought a car when he went there, a little Austin 7 open touring car. We'd call it a convertible, and drove more or less up the east side, traveled all the way up into Scotland to Aberdeen, you know, and along the east coast of Scotland. So he collected songs in Edinburgh area, really important particular tradition there of oyster dredging songs, and on up to Aberdeen. And from his description, he was kind of going from town to town. He'd show up in the town, he'd go down to the docks and sort of start asking around, any old sailors hanging around here? Anybody know any old songs? So it seems to have been kind of a bit random, but it was effective. He collected a lot of material.
For academics like Bob, the Carpenter Collection provides an exhaustive, one-of-a-kind overview of the shanty tradition and its evolution over time.
The collection actually offers a couple of different aspects or paths to understanding the genre, which are, I think, really special. One is the fact that the most common shanties, like Blow the Man Down, are songs that Carpenter collected lots and lots of times. And because his collecting technique was consistent across all of those times, you have very consistent examples to study. If you look at the published collections of shanties from other people, the versions that are in print are very often amalgamated from multiple sources, or they're from memory or whatever, or they're perfected or cleaned up. So it's not quite the same as listening to an original singer. And so if you're interested as a folklorist, which I am to a certain extent, in how do songs change in the course of their use and transmission from person to person, to have, as in the case of Blow the Man Down, 31 versions of the same song sung by different singers in different places, that gives you an opportunity to learn about the tradition and how a given song changes or exists across many different versions. So that's one thing that it offers. The other thing that the collection offers is because he was, you know, went to so many places and talked to so many people, are songs that don't occur in a lot of other places or are either rare or even unique to the Carpenter Collection. And so I'm interested in those songs too, many of which I've recorded on the CDs that I've made. And I sing those songs with people and hope to get them out there so people will enjoy them.
And because the recordings are, well, let's say low fidelity, is it difficult for you as a musician to kind of tease out the actual melody and the lyrics?
Well, yeah, it is. It's kind of a bother. There are a few of us who enjoy that sort of challenge, and so we take it on. The quality varies a lot. Some of them are pretty good, and it's pretty easy to see or hear what people were singing. Others are horrendous, and it's, you know, you're trying to make up something out of that. It's pretty hard.
And as a folklorist and musician himself, Bob found some unique inspiration among the scratchy recordings in Carpenter's collection, specifically a certain kind of shanty from Scotland that led to a musical coming home of sorts.
The dreg songs, which are songs that were sung by oyster fishermen in the Firth of Forth, are a particular specialty and really remarkable song that people in Scotland realized had vanished. And they were like, where can we find these songs? Are there any traces of them? Because there were descriptions of these songs from the 19th century, but the oysters in the Firth of Forth were overfished, and so the fishery just packed up sometime around the turn of the 20th century. And there was nobody doing that fishery and nobody singing these songs. But people had written about, oh, they used to sing these songs while they were fishing for oysters. And people were like, how do we find these songs? And there was, in the 1950s, a couple of folklorists that tried really hard to search for the long-lost dredge song. But what they didn't realize was that in the 1920s or early 30s, Carpenter had been in that area, in the towns of Fisher Row and Kakensie, and had actually recorded some of these songs. But because Carpenter's collection was not widely known, there was a little bit of memory in the community that some American had done something, but they didn't know whatever became of these songs. And so when it came as part of my work to transcribe these songs and try to make sense of all this material in the Carpenter collection, I'm like, what are these things? And I started to transcribe them, and they're musically really intriguing. And I was trying to figure out what's going on. And I found these articles about these folklorists who were searching for these long lost songs. And lo and behold, I had found them. There they were, sound recordings of these very songs that people had been looking for. Isn't that interesting? And so I started to learn about the songs and try to transcribe them and figure out what was going on. And the songs are actually really fascinating because they're work songs for rowing while towing an oyster dredge along the bottom of the Firth of Forth to scoop up oysters, right? They're a call and response song that has a different structure from any other sailor's work song that I've ever heard. The call or the solo is 3 beats and the response is 2 beats. So the unit is 5 beats long, which is unusual. So a song like the There's a bonnie ship, sailing o'er the sea. So it's these units of 5, which is great.
Into Harvard's house, along Nazareth town, and it's easy up, and it's towards the flat, start the flat, and darty full, and I'm fishing it.
I wrote an article about it. It's been published in a journal called Folklore. And I did a project where I worked with people in Scottish Coastal Rowing, which is a national project in Scotland, building rowing boats around the coast, and then they have races. But I brought some of these songs to people from 3 different rowing clubs, and we got together in Edinburgh, and we actually got the songs back on the Firth of Forth, people singing the songs where they hadn't been sung for 100 years, which was a kind of a cool outcome from the Carpenter Project and the work that we've done together.
Yeah, it's a great story, and it's very true to the spirit of his work.
Yeah, keep those songs alive. Bring them back.
It's worth noting that although the sea shanty tradition continues to resonate with modern audiences, many of the shanties' off-color lyrics don't align very well with the prevailing attitudes of today. How about this? Are there any sea shanties that have, in terms of their lyrics, aged particularly poorly given changes in attitudes and culture since the time they were first sung?
Most of them. Yep.
I had a feeling.
So, yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of issues with all kinds of songs, so that's a process that, you know, people who are seeing them in contemporary society are working their way through, so, which is as it should be.
Yeah. How did you get involved in the Carpenter Project out of the University of Aberdeen, and what sort of work have you done as part of it?
Well, I got involved in the project because years ago when I lived in Washington, D.C., I started hanging out at the Library of Congress, and that was 1979. And the Carpenter collection was at that point relatively new to the Archive of Folk Culture at the Library of Congress. And I have to thank Joe Hickerson and Jerry Parsons for introducing me to the Carpenter collection. They were excited about the collection at the time and said, you know, check this out. If you're interested in shanties, you'll be really interested in this. And I was interested in shanties, so I started listening to it and started transcribing some of the songs just for performing them myself to learn the songs and enjoy them. And so I spent a lot of time in the archive, you know, with headphones on, listening to these recordings and just exploring the collection. And so a number of years later, when Julia Bishop was thinking of doing a big project of publishing the Carpenter Collection, she is an expert in musical transcription and in ballads and in children's folklore, but is not an expert in sea shanties. And so she talked to the people at the archive and said, who knows anything about these shanties who could work on the Carpenter project? And they said, you should talk to Bob Walser because he's the guy that's been doing that for a while. And so out of the blue, Julia reached out to me and first of all invited me to do a piece for a special issue of the Folk Music Journal, and I wrote about the shanties there, and then we got to know each other. And then as she started putting together the team for the project, she invited me to be part of it, and it was good timing because it was just when I was finishing up my PhD and I was looking for a way to use my newfound skills, and it was a perfect fit.
And at what point did the Library of Congress end up with the collection?
1972. The story of Carpenter and the collection is a fun story. So he went to England and Scotland and Wales, and he recorded all this wonderful stuff, and he had all these cylinders, came back to the United States and started transcribing it. By this point, he'd completed his PhD, and he'd done all this research, and he got a teaching job initially at Duke and then in North Carolina. And was working on the collection. And like a lot of collectors at that time, his goal was to get the collection published in some way. And he tried to do that in various ways, he wrote letters to people, you know, would you support my doing this, whatever. But he never got it done. And so he sat on this collection for years and years and years. And it was really valuable. And the story goes that he kept all these cylinders in a big wooden box under his bed, and always with a rope nearby so that if the house caught on fire, he could lower the cylinders out of the window and protect the collection. I don't know if the story is true, but it's a great story. Anyway, he recognized the value of what he had, which he mentioned in letters that he wrote to people at other institutions that he thought might support the work, but it never happened. And so he got older and older and eventually realized that it wasn't going to happen. And Alan Jabor, who was then at the American Folklife Center, reached out to him to see if Carpenter would be interested in depositing his material with the archive, which he did. I believe that the archive bought it. I've never known what the money was. But anyway, in 1972, the collection came to the Archive of Folk Culture at the Library of Congress.
The Library of Congress became the official home for Carpenter's collection, but it's still an ocean away from the place where much of the material originated. Bob says that, at one point, cassette tapes were made and marketed by a folklorist in the UK, but copies of Carpenter's material eventually made their way back to Britain in a more formal way.
The real proper return to the UK has been through the English Folk Dance and Song Society, with whom the Carpenter team has collaborated, and that material is now all presented online through the Vaughan Williams Memorial Library website, vwml.org, I believe. And that's in cooperation with the folks at the Library of Congress, who have been absolutely terrific in supporting the work of the team and in supporting, you know, the continued study and appreciation of this amazing collection.
So for you and others involved in the Carpenter Project, what would you say are some of the big takeaways that have been gained from studying Carpenter's work?
Well, for me, the business that I mentioned earlier about there being 31 versions of Blow the Man Down and multiple versions of many others has allowed me to do some research in understanding a deeper level of what makes a shanty and what makes a shanty a successful shanty. Why were some songs way more popular than others? Which is a subject that I began to explore in my master's thesis at the University of Wisconsin-Madison back in the 90s. But the Carpenter material has allowed me to go much deeper in that and understand how does variation work? What parts of shanties are subject to a lot of variation? What parts are not? Why would that be? All those kinds of questions, which are interesting to me. The other aspect of it, specifically with respect to the shanties, has been the joy of bringing the lost repertoire to an audience that actually really enjoys it. I mean, a bunch of the songs that have come out of the Carpenter collection that I've recorded or that other people have recorded have been taken up by people in these shanty singing communities across the United States and around the world, and people are singing those songs. So in essence, that mission of salvage folklore that Carpenter participated in lo those many years ago has actually resulted in exactly what he would have hoped for, I hope, anyway.
Maybe even more than he could have hoped for.
Perhaps. Who knows? With the way it spreads on technology. I mean, because there's a group in London that organizes a shanty sing every Saturday, and people come online and participate from all over the world. And sometimes they sing a song that was collected by James Madison Carpenter.
Some poetic justice there. So I want to switch gears and ask you about your time working at Mystic Seaport in Connecticut. What exactly were your duties there as a shantyman? Did you teach?
Oh, that was a great experience. I loved it. When I went to work at the seaport, my primary job was to sing shanties. And it was to sing shanties for the visitors who came to the museum and also for the special demonstration squad, which actually did things like set sails and all nets and so forth. And so it was an opportunity to actually use shanties, partly, you know, to do programs and talk about them and show pictures or whatever, but also to use them on the deck of the ships and to go aloft and sing Paddy Doyle's Boots while we were tossing the bunt of a sail and sing Whiskey Johnny or Blow the Man Down while we're hauling on a halyard. It was a great experience. I treasure the memories of working at Mystic Seaport. It was a wonderful experience.
So along the lines of Carpenter, you were helping to keep the tradition alive a bit.
Oh, yeah. That was a great aspect of the museum. I don't think they're doing this anymore. I think they've dissolved this, which is a real, real tragedy. But to have the special demonstration squad actually going aloft and setting sails and showing people what it actually looked like. And there's a huge boom in shanty singing right now, as you probably know. There are shanty sings that happen all over the place, places all over the U.S. and other countries as well. So there's this huge interest in shanties. But most people who are singing them have absolutely no reference about what is a shanty proper, a real work song, not just a generically salty song. How does that actually fit to the work? And that was the thing that Mystic Seaport in the days of yore could provide. People could actually see how the work was done, hear the song in its meaningful work context. And that was a glorious thing.
It sounds like it. And you sort of predicted my last question for you. I know in early 2021, the sea shanty called Wellerman became a viral sensation on TikTok. And I'm not sure how closely you followed all that. But did the fact that that song took off surprise you?
No, it didn't. It's a lovely song. It's not actually a shanty, as lots of people have said, and even Nathan Evans, who made the initial TikTok and has since published a book about shanties, acknowledges that the song itself is not a shanty. But actually, I'm giving away something that I'm going to be writing a review of a few recent publications, and I haven't exactly got my lingo down for it. But the idea is that shanties are rife with atmosphere and ripe for commodification. So they're songs that have all kinds of associations with the sea and coming of age and all kinds of things like that. I mean, they're just full of atmosphere, and that's been the case forever. And interest in shanty seems to always be there at some level and to explode from time to time. But it's also ripe for exploitation, because something like that that is evocative of places and times and mystery and all kinds of things is a great opportunity to make a buck.
Any opportunity to be a little salty, we're going to jump in.
Yeah.
Well, Bob, that's everything I've got for you. I want to thank you so much for chatting about the song collecting odyssey of James Madison Carpenter nearly a century ago, and for talking about how his music has influenced your own life and your work. And I'm going to swing by Minneapolis, and you're going to teach me a shanty sometime.
Love to do it. Sounds like fun.
Okay, thanks again.
You betcha. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Oh, we were sitting in the parlor thinking over every plan when in came Palmer in a hurry to ship us on the Bridget Ann. Chitty shalong, shalong, shala. Hi-lo, chitty shalong, shala.
Well, that's my chat with Bob Walser. And the music you're hearing is the music of Bob Walser, from an album he recorded that features shanties adapted from the extensive collection of James Madison Carpenter. Bob's work is a testament to the lasting appeal of the sea shanty, and a tip of the sailor's cap to the man whose tireless travels nearly a century ago led to the preservation of a tradition worth saving. And speaking of tips of the cap, I'll let the final word go to the man himself, James Madison Carpenter, speaking about the sailors whose songs he saved.
And they were always pleased to know that their songs were preserved, they'd be saved for somebody. Well, that was the reason I said the other day that I was so eager to have some of them published. You see, where the folk could hear and sing the songs again.
For Keeps is a production of me, David Peterkofsky. My thanks to Bob Walser for shedding light on the sea shanties collected by James Madison Carpenter, and for sharing his insights into why the sea shanty tradition captures our collective fancy. At ForKeepsPodcast.com, you'll see photos of Bob, James Madison Carpenter, and some of the items in Carpenter's massive collection. And in the show notes, there's a link to the digitized version of his collection, featuring scans of Carpenter's typed song lyrics and sheet music, as well as audio files of those recordings he made as part of his fieldwork. The show's theme song is by Still Flyin, and the closing theme is by Eric Frisch. And, in a nod to the adaptability of the sea shanty, additional music for this episode was provided by Cameron Dale, whose album Sunken Songs features instrumental reworkings of shanty classics. You can visit the show online at ForKeepsPodcast.com or follow For Keeps on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at For Keeps Podcast. If you're a fan of the show, hit the subscribe button, hit the share button in your podcast player, or post a positive review for it wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening to For Keeps. Until next time, keep on keeping on.